Welcome to another episode of Making Something Cool from Scratch, even if it has already been done a million times by other people who know what they're doing, because it's fun and we can learn a lot from it. Last episode, I showed you my terribly optimized but functional ray tracing engine, which you seem to have really liked. Today, I want to stay in the spirit of 3D rendering and create a 3D gravity simulator in C++ using OpenGL. The reason I started working on this project 2 months ago was because I discovered this fun 2D gravity simulator on the internet. And at the same time, Sebastian Lack made this amazing video where he created a solar system in Unity, which inspired me to mix both ideas to create a 3D gravity simulator. And to make things more interesting and not just copy Sebastian Lack's impressive work, I'm not going to use any existing rendering engine, so I'll have to do all the rendering myself. Now, before I tell you more about gravity and real-time 3D rendering, I want to thank you all once again for your amazing support. I've been receiving a lot of very nice comments recently and my channel has grown much faster than I expected, which is really motivating. However, most of the viewers of this channel don't actually subscribe, meaning it would make a big difference if you could just click on that big red button down below. It takes a long time to make these project videos in my free time, and you might miss the next one, so please consider turning on notifications if you enjoy this kind of content. Before starting to work on the rendering, which I think will be the most challenging part of the process, as I have very little experience with OpenGL, I want to do a small recap about Newtonian gravity, because no, I won't be simulating general relativity, sorry. Also, I might oversimplify things, or even make a mistake or two. So if anyone knows more about physics than me, go ahead and correct me in the comments if I'm wrong. All objects in the universe attract each other based on their mass, and this is called gravity. The force with which two objects attract each other can be calculated using this formula, where g is the gravitational constant, which in our universe is this very small number. By dividing the total gravitational force which affects an object by the object's mass, we get something called acceleration, which describes how the object's velocity changes over time, and the velocity itself describes how the object's position changes over time. The initial velocity of an object defines the path it will follow when approaching another massive object. Too slow and the object will crash into the other. Too fast and it will just fly by. But then there's a nice middle area where the object will orbit the other forever in a perfect circle or an ellipse. Okay, now that this small recap is done, we can start working on the project. I'm not exactly sure what I want to make just yet, but the first thing is setting up a basic rendering engine. I quickly set up a C++ project with Visual Studio and installed a few libraries to get the latest version of OpenGL going. I then pasted some code I wrote a few months ago, which contains all the essential code and shaders needed to render a colored cube on the screen. By this point, I think I should start talking about rasterization, which is the rendering technique OpenGL is made for, and is the most common one for real-time rendering. In a nutshell, rasterization is just a fancy way to draw triangles on the screen. The key is manipulating these triangles to create an illusion of 3D. So imagine we have this cube. It is made up of 4 vertices connected in a specific order to form 12 triangles. If you're wondering why we work with triangles instead of quads, it's because every shape can be constructed using triangles, because they are the most primitive polygon. All vertices of the cube have an XYZ position relative to the model's origin, so we can say that this position is in model space. Our goal is to apply a set of transformation to the vertex position to get their position in screen space, which are XY coordinates relative to the center of the screen. Because if we have that, we can just fill in every pixel which is inside the triangle with the correct color, as long as we make sure not to fill in triangles where they are hidden by others. To get these screen coordinates, we start by adding the model's position relative to the world origin to the position of the vertices, to convert them from model space to world space. We then need to define the position and rotation of our camera, which represents the point from which the world will be rendered. We then simply apply the opposite transformation of our camera to all vertices, so if our camera is positioned at x5 in the world and rotated 90 degrees on the z-axis,
We will translate all vertices in the scene by negative 5 on the x-axis and rotate everything by negative 90 degrees relative to the camera. All vertex positions are now in view space. Now comes the most important step. Because our eyes capture incoming light from an angle, everything we see gets distorted, which is the reason why far away objects appear smaller. This is called perspective. Calculating the correct transformation to account for perspective is complicated, but a simple way to think about it is that vertices are moved closer together the farther they are away from the camera. So because our screen coordinates are centered at 0,0, we can basically just multiply all view space vertex positions by a number that starts at 1 and gets smaller and smaller the further away we get from the camera. By the way, in practice, all these transformations are done using matrix multiplication. In this context, a matrix is basically a bunch of numbers that store transformation data, and multiplying a vector by a matrix transforms that vector by the transformation stored in a matrix. And so, perspective is taken care of by a special matrix called the projection matrix. After applying all these transformations, we can effectively ignore the z component of the vertex positions, and we now have our screen space coordinates, which we can use to draw all the triangles to the screen.
So, that was a relatively long introduction to rasterization, but you should now have a better understanding of this rendering technique, which I'll be working with to create this project. So let's get back to it. Now that we have all necessary stuff to render 3D objects with OpenGL, I started working on the basic file structure of the engine by splitting different parts of the code into separate files. This will be a lot easier to work with, but it came with the unfortunate trade-off that I couldn't get it to work anymore, which was to be expected. The good news was that the problem could be solved with a very small change, but the bad news was that it took me multiple hours to find it. Debugging C++ really isn't an easy process. Anyways, now that the basic rendering pipeline was complete, I could easily render as many objects as I wanted, which worked perfectly. Okay, so cubes are cool and all, but we want spheres, as large cube-shaped bodies aren't really that common in the universe. To render spheres, we need a way to generate a spherical 3D model. There are many different ways to do that, but I'll go for one of the more common methods, the UV sphere, which is made out of different circles of vertices called rings and segments, connected together in squares, which are made out of two triangles each. I started working on a way to generate a sphere model in Unity, because it would be easier to test different ideas. It didn't work on the first try, but I did get some interesting results. And eventually, I managed to generate a nice sphere. Now that I had a working algorithm for generating and triangulating a sphere, I implemented it into the C++ project. This is what I got. So we do have a spherical shape, but something's definitely wrong here, and it looks like it's a problem with the normals. To understand what's going on, we need to understand how shading works with rasterization. So here's a quick recap. So as you know, a 3D model is made out of vertices, which are initially defined by a three-dimensional vector relative to the model's origin. But in addition to storing all the vertex positions, we also store another three-dimensional vector with every vertex known as the normal vector, which defines which way the surface should be facing at that point. Then, when filling in the triangles, we can estimate the orientation or normal of the surface at every pixel by interpolating between the normal vectors of the surrounding vertices. And if we know where the light is coming from, we can use the angle between the normal and the light direction to determine that pixel's brightness. And so, if the vertex normals are missing or miscalculated, we get weird results like what's happening here. Luckily, the normals of a sphere are very easy to calculate, as a normal vector at any vertex is just the direction from the center of the sphere to that vertex, which we can find out by normalizing the vertex position, as it should be defined relative to the center of the sphere. So with the correct normals, this is how it looks. Perfect. I then tried generating spheres with different resolutions, which will allow me to lower the vertex count of spheres based on their distance from the camera, which should make things run more smoothly when there are a lot of objects in the scene. I then modified the shaders to account for different colors, which worked nicely. I then wanted to add a background to make space less empty, which I did by creating a big sphere around the camera with normals facing inside. And I tried applying a texture to it, which really didn't look great. What I ended up doing was creating a special shader program for the background sphere, which draws many small white dots with different sizes on the sphere, which in my opinion looks great. For those who don't know, a shader program is a program that will be executed in parallel on the GPU, so it can be used to process a lot of data very fast, or in the case of the fragment shader, compute the color at every pixel of any triangle on the screen. With most of the visual stuff out of the way, I felt ready to finally implement the actual gravity simulation, which, as I had expected, was much easier than the rendering part, as I just had to stick to the simple calculations I mentioned earlier. Here's an example of a small body orbiting a bigger one. So guys, I think this is where I'll end this part. I know that I've mostly talked about rendering in this video, but that was certainly the most challenging part of the project. In the next part, we'll add camera movement and some simple UI to the simulator, and hopefully the next video won't come out as late as this one did. I'm really sorry for the wait, by the way. I had to work on a lot of stuff in the past few months, so I didn't have much time to work on this channel, which was really frustrating considering how fast the channel has grown since the last video. In fact, the subscriber count has more than doubled since that video, which is incredible. Thank you all so much. And if you haven't already, please consider subscribing to help maintain this growth. Don't forget to leave a like if you enjoyed, and let me know in the comments what you thought of this video. And if you have any ideas for the next part, leave them there too. Thank you very much for watching, enjoy the end of 2020, and I'll see you in the next one.